Yeah, so when I moved to New York again, like, you know, I was kind of, that's when I started collecting markets more seriously. And all through college, and I lived in LA for 7 years, and when I lived out there, I didn't have a record player or anything like that. I'd move it around, it would have been a lot to kind of carry all those equipment and records around from place to place. But when I moved out here, I felt like it was a little bit more established in where I was, so I decided I wanted to get a record player, because I had a record player in my house since I was a kid. So, you know, I went down to Turntable Lab in NYC and started looking. I wanted to get kind of a, you know, like a decent record player, my first decent record player. It's actually a record player I'm still using, which is just a Project Debut Carbon. You know, at the time I was just running through like a sound bar, and then I started investing in like amps, and you know, I got really heavy into tube amps and things like that, and speakers. I think it's my third set of speakers, where I just keep on changing them and stuff like that. I mean, the first song I learned how to play on bass was Miles Davis' So What? And you know, just get the bass line, that's so great. And you know, it's like really the standard of like what jazz is to me. And the way, like, when I think about jazz, that's how it's structured, is that album. So that was really the first time I had exposure to it. And then I started researching more into jazz and learning more about it. And, you know, one of my best friends growing up, you know, we used to go over to his house and play video games in his basement. His dad had probably 10,000 records in his basement. And I remember asking him, like, oh, like, you know, oh, I'm learning how to play bass, just found out about some Miles Davis stuff, can you recommend anything else? And of course, then he started ripping all his vinyl and CD, because CD was the thing at the time, and like giving me all these, like, he gave me this copy of Miles Davis Live at the Fillmore East, which that album is just, that's probably my favorite Miles Davis album, just because it has like that kind of weird fusion where he's going a little bit more electric and it's a little bit more avant-garde, but it's still kind of got the structure of it. And, you know, but then even too, you know, he started talking about the correlation between like Miles Davis and Jimi Hendrix, and how Jimi Hendrix had a big influence on, you know, Miles Davis wanting to go electric. Because, you know, when he was at the studio and he heard Jimi Hendrix recording live at the studio, you know, he was like, oh, I gotta stay relevant and I gotta do this. And that's where it kind of, apparently, I don't know if it's true or not, but Bitches Brew and all that stuff came out of the fact that he heard all this electric music and he didn't want to be left behind. And, you know, but like this guy who, you know, had all these records that he'd show me all this stuff in Allman Brothers and stuff like that. But that was really my first exposure to jazz, was the whole Miles Davis kind of blues, and learning how to play that on bass, which was great. All my life, I was like, I looked at scratch DJs, and I was like, that's cool. And I was like, they came out those portables, and I was like, oh, great, like $100, get some 7-inch scratch records. And, you know, and then like, I was like, oh, okay, well, now I'm learning how to scratch, but I didn't really like any of the beats I was finding, so I was like, I want to make beats. And then, so I was like, well, how'd they do this? So I went out and I got like, I got an OP1, which is like, you know, Teenage Engineering's like little synth, and you could chop up samples and use it to produce like hip hop tracks. And, you know, I started messing around with that, and I started researching, you know, what, you know, obviously in the 90s, like what people that I remember listening to in the 90s, like what samples were they using? And then I started like getting more into soul and funk, because obviously that's what they were sampling, soul, funk, disco. And I started going down that route, and I just started like trying to learn as much as I can. I was constantly in the record shop just asking questions, right? And it was just talking to anybody that would talk to me and give me a free education. And I like got the 45 bug, and it's a sickness. And if you don't collect 45s, don't, because it's an addiction. And then, you know, I started getting into like playing records, and I found like, you know, a bar I go to in New York City, it was like, they had turntables. I was like, oh, hey, can like...
What bar is that?
It's Black and White. And I was like, oh, like, you know, like, it would be okay if like, you know, I saw you had some turntables, like, could, you know, we collect 45s, it was me and my buddy, and we're like, oh, maybe we can play some records here. And the guy was like, instantly, he was like, oh, well, we had DJs. He was like, oh, well, you know, we're just trying to have an excuse for friends to come out. He was like, yeah, but I can't pay you. And I was like, oh, we don't want to get paid, we just want to play records. He's like, oh, like two completely changes. He's like, yeah, no, anytime you want. And so you know, now like once a month we're down out at Black and White, just playing 45s. And then
still
like
to this day.
Still to this day. I mean, we're playing next Thursday.